anybody tired this morning? I had a wonderful turkey shoot last night, had a good turnout, and good fellowship, good fun. And so I want to thank everybody that came out and helped us with the women in the kitchen, the men on the course out there. Thank everybody for your participation. We all need to have all hands on deck, and we met some people we've yet to meet in the community, so thank God for that. But wonderful demonstration last night for we are as an outside. Stand with the house, let's get the Lord in prayer. Ask God to meet our needs and bless us today. Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, to come to your house, God, and magnify who Jesus Christ is. We're thankful, God, today for the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us, oh God, and makes us whole. We're praying, God, your spirit, Lord, in this house, God, so rich and real, God, today. We need a drawing, God, by your spirit and by your power. Let us know we leave the house today. We've been changed by the presence of a living God. Draw us close to you today, God. We need you greatly, oh Lord, to come and demonstrate who Jesus is in the house today. Walk among thy church today. We praise you and we glorify for all things. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Today also, 5 o'clock. If you want to join the choir, come out tonight, practice with them, and that'll be this evening. We're still doing the fundraiser. It's extended till today. And today's the last day, so let Linda know if you want to order something in the catalog, and they'll get your order submitted. Women's Auxiliary meeting this week, 7 o'clock. Invite all women to come and attend. It's a good time of devotion, fellowship, and refreshments. Team Kids continue on this Wednesday night, 6:30, bring the kids out for supper, and then 7 o'clock starts the program. Invite somebody to come with you. It's been a good, awesome outreach for us as a church, and we've seen it grow. We've seen a lot of kids come out for us, and invite somebody to come. Wednesday night, we're back out here once again at 7 o'clock for the midweek Bible study and prayer meeting together. Nothing like that midweek pickup that we all need to get us through the remaining of the week. Turkey shoot will continue on next Saturday and the Saturday after that. We do have the women working the kitchen with the food sales. We do need monetary donations and things you can provide for us. See the list there. Let Lou know if you can donate something on that behalf. We also need volunteers to help us. We worked a lot last night. A lot of folks put a lot of effort into it. But it would help to have more volunteers to help us facilitate it, give some breaks. So let us know if you can help out. Also, next week, Melissa brought this to my attention this morning, we're going to have the children over here next Saturday night during the turkey shoot. A lot of them running around doing s'mores and stuff. We kind of want them to be kind of a safe house and have a place to come. So we're gonna have a movie out here for them, have some more, it's not out the door here, so they can participate in that. And we'll probably have a sign-in sheet, to sign them in, and sign them out, and the parents come to pick them up. But we'll give them a list on that for more details, but have them out here next Saturday. Night in Bethlehem, we're gonna go to that December the 4th. We'll plan to leave here at 5:30, and 6:30, the program starts for us. We do have some spots available, if you want to come, let us know. And we're gonna have a church school going on ready, but if you want to come, let us know, and we'll put you on the list to go. Miss anything? Let Melissa know, you wanna go? Okay, all right.
Matt, I have been there two or three times, and I've had an acting, it's a wonderful experience, you get to make things. And at the end, you will be at a tournament with that home. And we've had, like, three or four ones to sit on my tour, and they're beautiful. But it's a great experience.
Good to know somebody's been, so.
Yeah, we'll be in about 3 years.
Awesome. We're planning to go to church this year and enjoy it for ourselves. Emily, you got something you wanna speak on?
Well, good morning again.
Good morning.
I just wanted to take a moment to tell you about a men's fellowship meeting that's held each month, second Monday night of each month, except December, Stony Hill Federal Baptist Church, north of Middlesex. And you say a meeting at Stony Hill, okay, so what's the difference about that? Well, this is not a meeting held by Stony Hill Church. It's a meeting where a number of Christian men from 10, 12, or 14 different churches go. And for good food and good fellowship. And I can't think of anything better than that for Christian people to get to know other Christian people. And it's the testimonies that are shared are really good. And it's kind of interesting, Matt was there last month, the month before last. And he was asked to pray for service. And one guy told me, he said, you know, he said, that man, he said, I can tell about that man, but just listen to his prayer. Yeah. So the meeting is tomorrow night. It's the last meeting of this month. I said, Stony Hill Federal Baptist Church is about north, 1 mile north of Middlesex. And we have privilege and pleasure of Matt being the speaker tomorrow night. So, for some of you guys that have never been, please come and give it a try. You're going to enjoy it. First, you're going to meet a lot of other Christian men. You're going to have some good food, and you always hear a good testimony as somebody shares about their life and what's happening in and at this time of your life. So come and listen to Matt tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, Stony Hill Federal Baptist Church.
We look forward to doing it tomorrow night. Gentlemen, it is good food. I went there a couple months ago. It was awesome food, good fellowship. And it was a good time to come together. We can endeavor to bring the word tomorrow night to people there. Is there a need in the house up with your hand? Anything outspoken today?
I'm
received it today and she's at the hospital doing the bonding.
I like prayers well for my son, Jason Melvin, and his family that was dealing with him, and God to take over.
Put Christ in the faith. Anybody else?
Matt, remember Miss Jeanette Dupree? She's home and she's on hospice care, but she is leaving to go to Georgia to stay with her girl so she can look at her.
And praying for that transition.
I have a praise for my son. He had his MRI last week and it turned out good. It looked good and he's continuing his therapy. Pray God to continue to bless and heal him. And thank him for all the blessings he's given so far. All those that are sick with cancer, back pains, all the problems that we face, pray God to continue to bless us and bless this country, that we'll turn to God and pray for our leadership.
It's the only answer.
That's right.
The true revival is us to turn back to God and be repentant of the sins that we've committed against God.
Amen.
And turn from those things and truly acknowledge who Christ is and who God is. Anything else in the house? Stand with the church, let's pray, let's believe. Let's ask God to intervene, ask God to move. We know that he can. Can he do it, church? Let's pray, believe this morning that he can. But we pray, Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, God, we know that you got power, God, to save and power, Lord, to heal. We know, God, that salvation, God, is of you and you alone. And we come, God, asking, Lord, for that salvation, Lord, upon the house. Asking, God, for healing virtue, God, to flow from Emmanuel's veins, oh, God. When that blood begins to flow, God, we know it'll heal. God, it'll set free, it'll deliver. We pray for every sickness in the house, oh, God, that Christ would reach down to touch it, God. Those who need help this morning, God, that you reach down to help them. Pick them up from the place, God, where they may be. And raise them up to sit in heavenly places with Jesus Christ. Lord, challenge us this morning, God, to receive the good news of the Word of God. We need to be changed by your Word, changed by your Spirit. We need to know above all things, God, that the power of God is still in the written word of the living God. Lord, touch thy church, God. Touch every situation, every circumstance, every child, God, every adult, God, that has a sickness in their body today. God, heal them and touch them. We know that you can, God. We know that you will. We touch and agree as well as one in touching faith, God, believing, God, that you're going to come down and do great and wondrous things among thy people. And we praise you and we glorify in the name of Jesus Christ to ask it. Amen.
You can be seated while the fire makes
Thank you.
shelter this morning.
Amen.
The one shelter, I don't know what we've been, what we'll be at. Thank God for the shelter, and all the God that secures us and keeps us. Nothing like a line upon you. It's time to receive the tithes and offerings of the ministers first. Come on, tell them. Sorry, out of order.
I'm routine.
Are you ready? Veterans Day is November the 11th each year, and this year it falls on Thursday. We often lose the real meaning behind the official holidays. They are held so that we will remember events. They are held so that we will never forget. Veterans Day is a U.S. federal holiday and is a time to honor and thank those who are serving or have served in the military and are still with us. Originally called Armistice Day, commemorating and signing of the agreement that ended World War I at 11 o'clock a.m. November the 11th, 1918, this federal holiday was changed to Veterans Day in 1954. At that time, it became a day to honor all the men and women who have served in the armed forces of the United States. Reverend Ray Hodge wrote an article for the Kenley News several years ago, and it read, "It is important for all Americans to know about and to observe Veterans Day. It is important for Americans to be aware of the high price so many of its citizens have paid for peace and freedom. This special day should help all of us remember what has been done and what is currently being done for all of us by those who have served in the military forces of this country. The freedom and privileges that we enjoy has been gained at a very high price. We must never forget the men and women who paid for victory with loneliness and fear of deadly battles, deprivation, painful and lasting injuries, and death itself. We owe it to those here with us to continue to be grateful for their contributions to freedom. And we must keep telling the following generations about the high cost of freedom. There were also millions of veterans who, though they may not have been in actual combat, placed themselves in harm's way and gave many months and years to serving this nation. Let us salute our veterans and challenge others to do so for their efforts past and present as they continue to serve this country and continue to provide and protect freedom for all Americans and others in the world." And those were Reverend Hodge's words. Mount Zion has the honor to have had many men and women serve this country in times of war and conflict and in times of peace. We would like to recognize those who are with us this morning for your service to our country. Would all of you who have been in service please make your way to the front? Now. We are privileged to have a member, Gunnery Sergeant Travis Nairn, currently serving in the Marine Corps in Germany, and his mother, Diane Nairn, standing in for him. We are also privileged to have a member, Airman First Class Trey Shirley, currently serving in the Air Force, and his father, Todd Shirley, is standing in for him. He's here.
don't even care.
Please start on the end, if you would, on focus from me, and give us your name, your branch of service, and the years served, please.
Health and Power, 5760. Army. Raymond Adams, Air Force and U.S. Army, 30 years.
Hunter Klein, U.S. Army, 6 years.
John Spence, Air Force, 1967-1970.
Todd Shirley, U.S. Navy, 1989-1997.
Trey Shirley, Air Force, almost 1 year.
Darrell Chapman, U.S. Navy, 68-74.
Danny Sergeant Travis Senior, and he's starting 16 years.
On behalf of Mount Zion Original Free Will Baptist Church, thank you for your military service to all of us, this community, and this country. Words can never adequately express our appreciation for your sacrifice on our behalf to help the United States of America continue to enjoy the freedom we so often take for granted. God bless you, and again, thank you. And now while we're all standing, would you please show your appreciation to them? And we're going to sing that one verse in your song sheet of God Bless America. While they make their way back to their seats. Thank you.
got the end of service, we'll start mid-service here, then we got some that's in nursery, some participating in children's service, so we're gonna go ahead and have the joining now. All those I've talked to about potentially joining, as you come to the front this time. It's a beautiful bunch. A lot of them have been working in the church, and we thank God for their services in that regard. We thank God they want to be a part of Mount Zion Church and helping us to carry the gospel forward. They all understand that, you know, church membership does not save you. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that saves us. But they understand that, and we're proud to have them to come before the church this morning to get joined. And I told most of them that I don't preach church membership, but I do preach a voice inside the church congregation in which we represent. So it's good to have that voice, let them be a part of that. And at this time, I bring all of them before you as the church congregation, and I want to ask, do I get a motion to accept membership on behalf of them this morning? Motion, do I get a second?
Second.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
All opposed, the same. Welcome to Mount Zion Church. Give each one of them a membership card to fill out for us. And I'll fill this out and get back to us. Absolutely. Start here, Brad.
I'm Brad Sullivan, Kaylee Sullivan, and Alyssa and Elena couldn't make it tonight.
I'm Hunter Klein. This is the wife, Jessica, and her daughter, Emma.
I'm Danny Bird, Malachi Bird, Matthew Bird, and Nevaeh Bird, and my wife, Adrian.
Jason Wheeler, Shana Wheeler's husband. He is Mackenzie and Faith Wheeler. And my mom's here too.
I'm Ken Stevenson. This is my daughter, Serena Stevenson. This is my wife, Lucy Stevenson.
Don't hold it against me. Accept my membership. Motion, second, eyes. Thank God for that. This time, Tommy, take it away. We'll have a special one. We'll dismiss, and then we're going to kill this trip.
Once in a while, we might drift a little bit too far
get away from church, and it's easy to miss a Sunday, and then another Sunday. And after a while, you get too far, and if you're drifting out in the ocean, you get too far out, you get to an undertow anyway. And that's bad when you get that undertow, because it's a hard thing to get back. The name of it's drifting too short, far from the shore. Out on
representation of freedom. Thank God this earth as well. We got a lot of representation this morning of the armed forces. Thank God for it. A lot of representation this morning. Isaiah chapter 53, turn there with me this morning. This should be familiar to us. Should be one we've digested, that we've put inside of our spirit and recognized. This is a representation. This is talking about prophetically about Jesus Christ. It talks about his sufferings. It talks about his affliction. It talks about his sorrows. It talks about all those things because of me and you. And I want to bring us to an identification this morning of what it means to really follow Jesus Christ. We talk about Father, we talk about the things that Christ went through, that Christ endured. But if we really come to recognize, if we come really to relate and be acquainted with what Jesus Christ did for us. Isaiah chapter 53, starting in verse 2, amen, if you're with me. It says, for he, talking about Christ, shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root of a dry ground. He has no form or no comeliness, and we shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. Verse 3 says, he's despised, underline that in the word of God, he's despised, he's rejected of men, a man of sorrows, underline sorrows, and acquainted with grief, underline that in the word today. As we hid it, as were our faces from him, he was despised, and he was esteemed, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But thank God for verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed this morning. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to slaughter, and as a sheep before the shearers is dumb, so he opens not his mouth. Now in verse 11, he shall see of the travail of his soul, he shall be satisfied by his knowledge, shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, he shall divide the spoil of the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. Underline that in the word of God this morning. He was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. This morning, if you give me just a few minutes of your attention, getting acquainted with the Savior. Getting an acquaintance with who Jesus is. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, God, we thank you, Lord, today for your power, God, to transition and change our lives. We thank you, God, for the events we've had already this morning, but I am praying, God, now that your word, God, would come forth, that it would birth inside of our hearts, that we would understand, God, what it means to be acquainted with Jesus Christ. Not just talk about it, not just go through religious motions, God, but truly know what it means to be acquainted with Jesus Christ. We need to know that this morning, God, that we're living in a terrible, tough world. But in that terrible toughness, oh God, we find a Christ, oh God, that walks with us and endeavors, oh God, to be with us daily, God, always, as long as we walk with him. Help you certainly bring forth thy word, God, in truth and in clarity, and give us strength in everything, God, and look to you by your grace and mercy. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Getting acquainted with the Savior. I don't have to tell you that in modern Christian thought, we think, you know, that everything's just going to be happy-go-lucky. We think in American Christianity, well, Lord, if I do this, then I'll be blessed upon measure. I have materialistic wealth that compares to nobody else. We think when coming to Christ, that it's just an easy road to go from that standpoint. Well, I come to tell you this morning that Jesus Christ had a tough road to get to Calvary. And if we're going to follow Jesus this morning, it's going to be a tough road to get to heaven. I come to tell somebody, you may have come in the house today down, you're tired, you give out. But I come to tell you about the Lord Jesus Christ. He was down and out. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was acquainted with grief. He was acquainted with sorrow. But he endured that cross for me and you. So I come to tell you that you've got to do away with the modern thought of Christianity, saying that you're going to have this and have that. There's a health and wealth gospel being preached now, and people are flocking after that for the masses. They think, well, I can have Jesus, I can have the goods of the world, and everything's going to be hunky-dory until I get down to heaven. No, church, I'm going to tell you, if you're going to be a Bible-believing Christian, there's going to be some persecution that you're going to face, going to be some tribulation you're going to have to go through, going to be some pain, going to be some suffering. But I come to tell you that Christ has overcome the world this morning. But Pastor, I don't want to endure those things. I don't want to go through that. Well, if you're part of the world loves its own. If you're in the world and you love the world loves you. But I'm going to tell you, if you're of a different world, the world to come, if you're a heavenly citizen this morning, then you're not going to walk the way the world does, but you're going to walk the way the Savior did. He was a Savior that was wounded for us. He was a Savior that carried that glorious cross for me and you. When he grabbed that cross and began to carry that, the weight was real. The weight was strong. But I'm going to tell you, he looked at me and you and said, I've got a purpose for that life. I'm tired of carbon copy churches. New age carbon copy churches. What are you talking about? I'm tired of every time I turn on the YouTube or something, there's another church group established, and they come in there and paint all the walls black. Got strobe lights in there. And some silly man gets on a stage in a pair of shorts and a t-shirt and wants to talk about how good God is and make a couple of jokes. And then everybody goes home. I'm going to tell you, church, this ain't about jokes. This ain't about religion. It's about Christ and endure the things he endures. We have painted an ungodly picture of what Christianity is about. We've taken out the cross. We've taken out the blood. It's the devil's for a different age, a different generation. But I come to tell you, it's the only thing that we need to have. And we've got there, we're going to progress the kingdom of God. Amen. Pastor, that's strong words for joining the church today. I just come to tell you what this is going to be about. Jesus Christ says, he says, remember the word that I said unto you. He said, the servant is not greater than the master. That means we're not above Jesus Christ this morning. He said, if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. Amen. The closer I believe that the coming of Christ is on the horizon, the more the church is going to be persecuted more than ever. The more affliction we're going to have to face. The more grief that we're going to have to go through. But I come to tell the church this morning, endure, church, because on the other side is a glorious throne that awaits us this morning. Lord God, we just push in. Just push on with God this morning. You see, this word, this Bible tells me and you what a Christian life is supposed to look like. God dips his pen inside of his word, and it paints a beautiful picture of Christianity, and it shows you what it looks like. But it's not beautiful from the natural eye, but it's beautiful from the spiritual eye. You walk by faith and not by sight. You see, Paul wrote that I may know him. We come to know Jesus Christ by way of his cross and the power of his resurrection. Everybody's jumping up now when it comes to know Christ and to be resurrected with Christ. We're all excited then, right? Should be. But then it goes on to say, and the fellowship of his sufferings. That means there's got to be a fellowship with the grief. There's got to be an acquaintance this morning with the sorrows of what Jesus went through. You say, but Pastor, he paid it all. He did pay for every sin, every transgression. He paid for all of that. But he did not promise you a bed of roses. He just told you to keep your eyes looking forward. Keep your eyes on the prize this morning. Don't look to the left. Don't look to the right. But look to Christ this morning. Amen. Fellowship of his sufferings. Being made conformable to his death. That means the old man is crucified. And God has raised a new man in Christ. And so we don't live after the old no more. You see, all the modern churches, they're painting a picture where the old man's revived, the old man's resurrected. They dress him up in a Pharisaical garb, religious speaking, if you will, and they call him the church of the living God. I will tell you, I'm not the man that I used to be. I went to a cross and got conformed to Christ, and now I've become a new creation in him. If you've not gone by way of the cross and not been to the tomb and been resurrected where your old man lays there, then are you a believer this morning? According to Bible doctrine, you know. See, Jesus said in Matthew 24 at the coming of the Son of Man, at the second coming, he said they're going to deliver you up for affliction. He says they're going to kill you. That don't sound like a good road, does it? But I believe the closer we get to the coming of Christ, the more affliction that we're going to have to face, the more persecution we're going to have to endure. And you've got to make your mind up today. Is God going to sustain me? Yes, he will. But you've got to put your hand to the plow and not look back. You've got to make your mind up today. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You've got to make your mind up today. They always say when you go into a prize fight or some type of fight, you may be fighting that you've got to win mentally first. And if you get inside there, you'll win physically. You've got to make your mind made to win spiritually. If you win spiritually today, tomorrow when the persecution comes, you'll say, thank God for the persecution. That I was accounted worthy to go through that persecution. That's what the disciples said when they were persecuted on every side when that church was first birthed and come forth. They were persecuted greatly. They said, thank God we were counted worthy to suffer that persecution for Jesus Christ. There's a man, we get the Voice of the Martyrs, the magazine they write about the persecuted Christians across the world. And one man said, I live every day in fear of my life. Every day I live, it could be a day that I take my last breath. He said, but you know what? I would have counted the world, I would have counted Christ worthy to take my life by this persecution. I would have counted it a glorious thing to know that I died for Jesus Christ. Can we say that this morning? Yeah. If they come in here and we go and say, hey, either denounce Christ or we'll take your life. What are you going to do? But what about my things I'm holding on to dear in this world? What is going to happen to them? Can I tell the church this morning, the Word of God tells us this over and over again, that this world's going to be burned up in fervent heat. It's all going to be demolished anyway. But the one thing you can take is your faith in Christ. When you hold on to the Word and hold on to Jesus, it don't matter what that world may offer you. Let it go this morning. And let God take over. You're preaching a lot of woe and woe this morning. There's two parts of this sermon. Jesus said, in this world you're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. When God raised up Paul to go preach the gospel on the road to Damascus in Acts chapter 9, said he saw a light from heaven and knocked him off his horse, and he fell on his backside, and he looked up and said, Jesus, who are you? How can Jesus who you persecuted? It tells Ananias in the way called straight, he said, you go pray for that man to receive his sight. But Lord, I've heard bad things about him. The Lord spoke to Ananias, he says, I have called him, and for my name's sake, he's going to have a lot of materialistic wealth. For my name's sake, he's going to have a mansion, old built over there on the side of the hill. He said he must suffer many things for my name's sake. That puts a different calling on the preacher of the gospel today. We thank Lord. We got celebrity pastors stepping up. They want to be a scene. They want to be the center of attention. They're up there instead of Christ. Look at me. Look what I've done. I've built all this. No, if a man is called by God, he'll be on his face before God saying, Lord, I'm the least in my Father's house. But God raised me up to preach the gospel. If a man will decrease and Christ will increase, you'll see God move in the church.
Right.
If man will get out of the way and say, Jesus is your platform, then my God, he will move.
That's right. That's right.
We want to be seen in the world.
Again.
My accomplishments, my achievements, we want everybody to look at us. And a lot of times we'll put Christ on that. Mm-hmm. Well, Christ, as you're blessed, Christ, you've done this. But really, the center of all that, Christ in the background, and I'm in the front of all that. If we would get small enough and get weak enough before God and say, Lord, I am weak, but I know you're strong. But in my weakness, oh God, you perform wonders. You perform power. You give strength to your church. If we would get that attitude, we would turn probably a little upside down. Not me, but you. Not I, but we as the collective body of Christ. In Acts 14, they went to the regions of Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch. And it says they were exhorting the believers in the faith that they must, through much tribulation, must enter the kingdom of God. The early church was built upon tribulation and persecution. It was built upon the sorrows and the sufferings of what that church is supposed to look like. Y'all bear with me. How many want to be like Samson? Me and Ray were talking about this morning. He said, you got your strength back? I said, what's coming? I feel good. I felt a long time since COVID. I said, I feel like Samson. He said, well, don't knock the pillars down this morning. He said, you just bring the word this morning. So I'm going to bring the word this morning. You see in Hebrews chapter 11, you see Samson. You see people of faith. You see Moses. You see people that didn't want the pleasures of the world for a season, but they sought for a better resurrection. They sought for something greater than what they could see in the natural eye. We look at that Hebrews chapter 11 and say, Lord, let me be identified with that crowd. Let me be up there in the glories of heaven, my name written down, saying, well, he stood for me during testing times. Who wants that this morning? We all should. But I'm going to tell you the latter part of that says, and it goes to the list of those names that stood up for God in the course of their generations. It says they were mocked, they were beaten, they were put in bonds, they were in prison, they were stoned, they were sawn asunder, they were tempted, they were slain with the sword, they were afflicted, they were tormented. But it says through all of that they obtained a good report. That means, church, if you want to have your name written in the hall of faith, you better obtain a good report by the things we face down here. You see, we are so accustomed to, Lord, if there's tribulation, I'm going to find me a chair to get up under and hide. Lord, that world out there telling me I can't preach no more. They're telling me I got to watch what I say. I'm just going to get behind here and let Jesus Christ come back and take me home. I wish somebody this morning said, you know what? I'm going to put aside my own endeavors. I'm going to put aside my own personal grief. And I'm going to say, Jesus, I'm going to march in the persecution. I'm going to march in the tribulation. I'm going to march in God. When the pain comes, I'm going to know there's a grace that helps me endure and carry on. What did tell Paul? My grace is sufficient for you. You'll carry that grace and carry you over. And we're beating you up enough. Word says that he was numbered with the transgressors. To be a true Bible-believing Christian, they call us criminals now. Because of our stance against homosexuality, because of our stance against abortion, because of our stance saying this is my body that belongs to God, it's a temple of the Holy Ghost, it don't belong to a government this morning. I've been bought, I've been paid for by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. It don't belong to nobody but the one that's bought and paid for me, church. I want to scream my body, my choice when it comes to abortion. Whole different element when it comes to some man that don't vaccine. I'm like, oh, I didn't come to preach a vaccine, I just come to preach mandates. I don't believe being mandated by a government or anything. I believe I pay my taxes, I do my part, I'm a law-abiding citizen, but they're not going to come knocking on my door, tell me what I'm going to do when I've been bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. And that's what you believe this morning, church. Do you believe this morning? Number with the criminals, that means we as believing Christians, we're already on the board somewhere because of our stance in Christ. You got something called the NSA? These cell phones? Me and my dad were talking about something the other night. I forgot what it was, Dad. So I looked down, they had an advertisement on my phone what we was talking about. I said, well, that devil's listening to me all the time. I've got to the place I'm going to talk to take it to the prayer room when I might hear my prayers. Maybe they need to hear my prayers this morning. My God, they need to hear what Christ is going to do to this earth if they don't commit their ways to him. Listen, we're numbered with them. Jesus Christ was rejected by religion. He was crucified by his disciples in John chapter 6. Most of them went away except for the inner 12. His family said, we don't believe you anyway. John chapter 7, verse 5, his brother said they don't believe him. How many's family have been rejecting him this morning at some point in time? Yep. Because of your stance for Christ. Yep. Even in his inner circle, Judas, a devil betrayed him. When he went to the garden and prayed, the men couldn't stay awake long enough to pray with him. But he prayed anyhow.
You're gonna be rejected by many facets of life, many things of life. That's where your faith is challenged. But I come to tell you there's a turning point in all of this. See, Jesus said, it says in the book of Hebrews, that for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. That means he endured the affliction, he endured the sorrow, endured the grief. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and now is set down the right hand of God. What are you talking about this morning? I come to tell somebody that God gives joy to his believers. There's joy in the strength of the life that is committed to Jesus Christ. My Lord, somebody may be in mourning this morning and say, I'm just crying over my situation. Can I tell you, if you'll follow Christ and endure the affliction, the word says it'll turn your mourning into dancing. My God, we can dance in the face of mourning. We can dance knowing that God is God. A lady tell me one time, she said, she's an awesome lady of God. She said, man, she should start dancing in your prayer room. I said, what are you talking about? She said, you start dancing in your prayer room. I'm wild, I don't dance. She said, start dancing. I was one point in time, I was tempted by something that was working on me hard. And I began to say, Lord, you know what? I won't dance in my prayer room. Devil, you ain't got my joy. You ain't got my victory. And I know who's got my back. When God backs his church, what needs you to do? Turn that morning into dancing. Isaiah 61:3, I'll give you beauty for ashes. If somebody burned up this morning through tribulation, can I tell you that God's coming by way of that cross to give you some beauty this morning? He'll give you the oil of joy for your mourning. The oil, a type of the Holy Spirit. When God takes the Holy Spirit and pours it on your life, there's a joy that overcomes you and overtakes you. Thank God for the oil of the Holy Spirit this morning that overcomes us and helps us through our mourning process. I'm almost done. It says that he'll give us a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Have you been so burdened down with the world? Burdened down with what you see? Burdened down by what you have felt? Burdened down by the persecution that you may experience? And we in that prayer room are like this. Oh God, Lord, what am I going to do now? I'm challenged on every side. There's a conflict everywhere I turn. I can't seem to get no rest. Even in the home that I come there, I can't get no rest there either. You know, it's one thing to better come home from work and better relax and just come together in that surrounding element of peace there. But sometimes we even there's a conflict. And so we get down that prayer room. God, I need you to help me. I need you to transition me. But I come to tell you this morning, there's a heaviness about you. If you say, Lord, let me put on the garment of praise this morning. Let me put a garment of worship. And say, Lord, through the affliction, through the persecution, through everything I face, I will praise you through it, God. Because I believe that you're a reward of those that diligently seek after you. I believe you, God, in the face of all these things. The least activity in most churches is praise and worship. If we're here this morning, we should thank God and thank us from last week. If we're here this morning, we should say, God, it's been a tough day, a tough week at work, been a tough week at home, been a tough week in the news, but Lord, I come to the house of God where liberty is. See, where the Spirit of God is, there's liberty this morning, church. Are you free? Are you free this morning? He puts on that garment of praise. We do. And he comes by to lift the burden off of us. And then we know our identification with Jesus Christ. He did all this for me and you. He was wounded for our transgressions. The chastisement of our peace is upon him. And he gives you peace this morning by what he's done for you at Calvary. Amen. Church, understand there's many things to come, many things we're going to face. But be encouraged this morning, because there's one that's already gone before us that's paved the way. And if you walk down that blood paved way, you got nothing to fear, nothing to worry about. Keep your eyes centered in Christ. Can we stand this morning? You know the week you've had, I don't. But if you want to come around this altar, we're going.